So, I mean, you always have functioned at a very high level. So I think that's probably why people were so surprised by the book. And I want to also point out for my viewers that, you know, to me, for Darrell, this is a, I'm so proud of, well, it's not the right word. I'm so excited that you decided to come out with this because this is such a common problem. And listen, this isn't the shadow of a big scandal at Penn State where somebody was abused, different kind of abuse, but still abuse. And I think this book comes out at a very important time. Did you want to help other people who were abuse survivors?
I know it sounds kind of arrogant, but, I mean, someone did say, I mean, if you could help one kid, would you do it? And I thought, yeah, because I've been wanting to write this book forever. And Saturday Night Live was over. There wasn't much going on. So I thought, let's do it now. But I've been wanting to write it for a long time. I've been wanting to write about agreements between perpetrator and victim in which the victim agrees to remain silent.
Tell me about that.
Well, the victim is terrified, you know, that something far worse than what's already occurred is going to occur. You know, I mean, as bad as more physical trauma could be a parent withdrawing their love from you.
Right, exactly. And you know, terror is the common denominator in abuse, and terror shatters the young brain's ability to regulate, which caused more emotional dysregulation now in adulthood. Now, I heard your Stern interview, Darrell. I thought it was fantastic. And two things jumped out that I think people would want to know. One was the magnitude of the abuse that you went through with your mom literally stabbing your tongue with a knife. That sort of got people's attention.
And, yes.
And that you've had treatment, that you went to a trauma program for 3 months. Is that right?
Yes, I was in a trauma program. I was in one program for 6 weeks, and then another one for the rest of that time, yeah.
I rarely get to talk to people publicly that have been on this side of the treatment process. Can you tell people what it's like to go from someone who's carrying all this emotional baggage and pain and dysregulation to into the recovery process?
Well, when the recovery process works and you start seeing results, it's damn fine. It feels great. All along the route, it's a pretty rough patch of road, you know. I mean, I couldn't have a breakthrough until I met this great doctor, and he had me every day for 6 weeks. And he got up inside my head, and I don't want to be too boring, but he figured out my core beliefs, world beliefs, beliefs about myself, figured out my inner dialogue, what my internal rules were, really got up in my head and saw how I was, you know, nosediving this aircraft every single day of my life.
And, you know, it's my opinion that the big challenge in being an abuse survivor is trust and being able to get close and open to another person. Would you agree with that, that learning that ability to stay close to somebody again?
You know, there's a great phrase in one of the 12-step programs that says the real problem here that we fail to recognize is our true inability to have a true partnership with another human being.
Right.
You know?
That's it.
I have, I've been... I'm a good friend, but I'm not good in relationships. I never have been.
And there was a substance piece of your recovery as well. How's your recovery going from addiction now?
Well, it's going pretty well because I'm not having night sweats and night terrors. I'm not having flashbacks. I'm not, you know, cutting anymore. I'm only on one medication now. I'm on Wellbutrin, which, you know, is not, you know,
that's nothing.
Too bad.
It's probably helping you not smoke. But you said something there that's very interesting that will slip past most people. You said you're not having flashbacks anymore. And I want to explain why that's such a packed statement. That when somebody is coming off drugs and alcohol, having withdrawal, even mild withdrawal symptoms, what we see all the time is vivid flashbacks to the traumas that they experience in their childhood. It's like they're revivifying everything just at the time when they're so miserable coming off drugs. Is that what you were talking about?
Yes, I'm talking about an instance where you're standing in a room and you're aware that you're in this room and you're aware of the carpet and the walls and, you know, all the other senses are working just fine, and yet you're back in that kitchen in Melbourne, Florida, and feeling exactly what you felt then when that was happening.
Now, I want to share an excerpt from Darrell's book. It's about his mother, Margaret. He writes, quote, "She used to recount cheerfully the time she beat me with her high heels and I began to bleed. I used to wake up in the morning wanting a mom, not my mom, but a mom. I wanted mothering, the magic I noticed in the hands and voices of other mothers." Darrell, there's many stories about your mom here, her, you at the railroad tracks, and her sort of letting you flirt with getting hit by a train, her hitting you with a knife in your tongue and all kinds of horrible stuff. Have you reconciled with her? Yeah. Have you been able to embrace whatever it was that made your mother the way she is?
I have. I mean, I've had to form some concept of forgiveness, but the way to do that for me was to actually realize that, A, I had become not such a nice guy in my life. I didn't break any laws or things like that, but I was selfish and I was mean. And I was ashamed that I had caused pain and fear for other people, and I was really ashamed of that. And I thought to myself, she must have been innocent at one time or another. And she did what she did because of something that happened to her. I did what I did because of something that happened to me. I mean, I always feel like cutting is not a problem. I think it's the solution to a problem that's going on.